Good morning, everyone. Today we are going to continue with our anatomy club on the Ryan Anatomy for Radiological Anatomy. Today, Dr. Dalal will talk about the skull and the facial bones.
Good morning. Today we will start with skull and facial bones. The calvarium is the brain case and comprises the skull vault and the skull base. The bones of the calvarium and face are joined at immovable fibrous joint, except for TM joint, which is a movable cartilaginous joint. We will start with the skull vault. Skull vault is made up of several flat bones joined at sutures, which can be recognized on skull radiograph. The bones consist of the bluic space, which is cancellous layer containing vascular spaces sandwiched between inner and outer table of the cortical bone. The skull is covered by periosteum, which is continuous with the fibrous tissue in the suture. The periosteum is called pericranium externally and on the deep surface of the skull called endosteum. The endosteum is the outer layer of the dura. And the bluic veins within the skull are large valvulous vessels with a thin wall. They communicate with meningeal veins, dural sinuses, and discal veins. This is the skull vault. First, okay, this is the scalp. We talk about that there is outer table and inner table. Sandwiched between them, a cancellous layer containing vascular spaces and the bluic veins. These veins are large, valveless, and thin-walled. The dura mater consists of two layers. The outer layer, called endosteal layer, which is the inner layer of the pericranium of the brain, while the inner layer of the dura is the meningeal layer. We talk that these veins are, which is the bluic veins, are communicating with many veins and sinuses, like the dural sinuses, the emissary veins, and meningeal veins. And now we will talk separately about each bone of the skull vault. The paired parietal bones, I will talk in the image. First, I will talk about the frontal bones. The two frontal bones form the frontal bone, which make the front of the skull. They
What's
unite.
The image? What is this image?
Not now.
CT
bone.
Which kind of CT?
Bone.
3D volume rendered CT scan. Okay.
CT volume rendered CT scan.
Volume rendered.
CT scan. 3D reconstructed. This is the two frontal bones, which form the frontal bone. It form the front of the skull. They unite by metopic suture, and frontal bone joint the parietal two parietal bones by anterior frontalier, or called the brigma, which unite the frontal and the parietal and frontal bones. The two parietal bones form much of the side and the roof of the skull, and unite by the sagittal suture. They have two parietal foramina, not present here. They are large foramina, even maybe palpable, and they may transmit emissary veins from the sagittal sinus. Just here to talk about that there is this superior sagittal suture. Of the parietal bone meet the lambdoid suture of the occipital.
Sagittal suture.
Yes.
Meets the lambdoid suture.
Suture at the lambda.
Okay.
Yes. And also the frontal suture meet the sagittal suture at the brigma, which is the anterior frontanier.
Frontal.
Of
the sagittal is the coronal.
Yes, coronal and sagittal. And this is the point of the intersection of the sutures of the frontal, parietal, greater sphenoidal and parietal bone, which is called the pterion. This is a landmark for the anterior branch of middle meningeal artery, which is, can be seen on lateral skull X-ray. This is the anterior branch of middle meningeal artery. It is also the site of the pterion, of the intersection of the sutures.
And what's the clinical importance of the pterion?
For the vessel.
Okay, bad.
Thin,
very thin.
Yes.
So it fractures a lot, easily fracture.
Yes.
And beneath it is the artery. So.
Label for bleeding.
Yes. Bleeding is common there.
Okay. Now we will talk about skull base from the anterior to posterior. There is orbital plate of the frontal bone with a cribriform plate of the ethmoid bone and crista galli in the midline. And the sphenoid bone with its lesser wing and greater wing and body with the elevated cella torsica in the midline and part of sequimotemporal bone and the petrous temporal bone and the occipital bone.
Yes. What does it mean, sphenoid?
I read about the meaning of it, but I forgot. Janah or
sphenoid were bahr and qaq. The birds, mythical, who, when you burn it, it rises up from the ashes and it never dies. Sphenoid, big birds, a story. Okay, so they named sphenoid to have greater wing and lesser wing,
body,
big legs, the plates, the trigoid plates.
Yes.
Okay.
This is the cribriform plate of the ethmoid bone, and this is the crista galli in the midline. This is the sphenoid body and the cella torsica inside it, and this is the lesser wing of the sphenoid, and this is the greater wing of the sphenoid.
This. Okay.
And this is the greater one.
So the floor of the middle cranial fossa is which one?
This, the lesser, the greater wing
greater
of the sphenoid.
Yes.
Is wing of the sphenoid. We talk that the sphenoid might consist of body and the greater wing and lesser wing of it. The important thing is that the body of the sphenoid house the sphenoid sinuses and is grooved laterally by the carotid sulcus. The carotid sulcus in which the cavernous sinus and carotid artery run. The sphenoid body has a deep fossa superiori known as cella torsica or pituitary fossa, which house the pituitary gland. This is the important. Cella torsica or pituitary fossa. I really search a lot about a better image for the pituitary fossa, but I didn't find only this picture from the Ryan.
Is this an
Google Play
better?
No. والله.
Yeah.
أنا
What does it mean, cella torsica?
ايه عارفه الحصان ال سرج الحصان او ال
سرج
ايه هو سرج الحصان
السرج التركي تورسيكا تركي الاتراك السرج مال الحصان ما تنسر من قدام ورا صاعد هيك
ايه
like the cella torsica okay so when they sit it plots on the pelvis okay so it's the Turkish saddle cella torsica
Cella torsica or pituitary fossa on the anterior part of the cella is a prominence known as tuberculum cella. Anterior to this is a groove called sulcus chiasmaticus, which leads to the optic canal on each side. Optic chiasm lie over this sulcus. There is two bony projections on either side of the front of the cella called anterior clinoid processes. The posterior part of the cella called dorsum cella, and this is continuous posteriorly with the clivus. two posterior projections of the dorsum sulli form the posterior clinoid process. The floor of the sella is formed by thin bone known as lamina dura, which may be eroded by raised intracranial pressure or tumor of the pituitary.
Wait, so, anterior clinoid process.
Doctor, بس دبح حكي على الصور.
Okay. Anterior clinoid process is part of which bone?
Part of the sphenoid.
Which part of the sphenoid?
Lesser. Lesser wing of the sphenoid.
So about the posterior process.
It is from the dorsum sulli. It is
part of which bone?
Dorsum sulli. Either the body of the sphenoid.
Yes. Okay.
Yes.
So anterior clinoid is part of the lesser wing.
Yes.
But posterior clinoid
from
is part
body.
Of the body of
the sphenoid.
Sphenoid.
Yes. This is the cella torsica. We said that anterior to it is a prominence known as tuberculum cilli. It is not obvious very much. Anterior to it is a sulcus called sulcus chiasmaticus, which run on it optic chiasm. And on the side of the optic chiasma, there is the optic canals, two optic canals. There is two bony projections from the... There are two bony projections from the side of the lesser wing, known as anterior clinoid process, this and this. While the posterior part of the cella called dorsum sulli. This is the dorsum sulli. And on each side of it, there are two bony projections from the body also called posterior clinoid processes. This dorsum sulli is continuous with the clivus, which is part of the occipital bone. We said that it housed the pituitary fossa, pituitary gland. Bilateral view, in the text mentioned that the better view to evaluate the pituitary is the lateral skull X-ray. This is the pituitary. أي other views أكو بس هو الماست كمان اللي used and it has certain measurement we will talk about. Temporal bone consists of four parts, squamous part which form part of the vault and part of the skull base, and pyramidal petrous part which house the middle and inner ear and form part of the skull base, while an aerated mastoid part and an inferior projection known as styloid process. I want to show you. This is the temporal bone, the squamous part, the petrous part, the styloid process, and the mastoid which has aerated cells.
First of all, should we have styloid?
I don't know. Nitu or bruise or something like that.
Styloid means pen. قلم. شايف الريشة القلم اللي كانت تكون فيه؟
Yes.
يشبهها.
Okay.
Looks like that. Okay. So it's like in French it's a stilo. قلم.
Okay.
Pen. Okay. Second, what does it mean petrous?
Petrous والله أعرف بس.
Petrous means صخري, rock-like, because it's so hard.
لأن أنا بالتنافس كله طلعت معاني أساسا كله.
It's very dense on an X-ray. It's very white. Okay. So you have a fracture of the petrous bone. There is severe trauma.
Yes.
I can know rock bone fracture.
Yes.
You have to know the meanings of the word.
Hey, in the preliminary, but now I forget.
You are now postgraduate.
The occipital bone, the curved occipital bone form part of the skull vault and posterior part of the skull base. It has foramen magnum in the midline through which the cranial cavity continues with the spinal canal. Anterolaterally, it's continuous with the posterior part of the petrous bone on each side, and anterior to the foramen magnum, it forms the clivus. The clivus is continuous anteriorly with the dorsum sulli. Thus, the occipital bone articulate with both the temporal and sphenoid bones. The occipital condyles for articulation with the atlas vertebrae project from the inferior surface of the occipital bone lateral to anterior half of the foramen magnum. This is the occipital bone. We said that anteriorly there is the clivus. The clivus is continuous with the dorsum sulli, and lateral to the foramen magnum, there is the petrous part of the temporal bone. And not shown here on the lateral side, on the anterior half of the foramen magnum, there is the condyle for the articulation of the atlas vertebra. Cranial fossa, there is three: anterior, middle, and posterior cranial fossae. The anterior cranial fossa is limited, now we said, posteriorly by the sphenoid ridge and anterior clinoid processes, and support the frontal lobes of the brain. While the middle cranial fossa is limited anteriorly by the sphenoid ridge and the anterior clinoid process, you imagine.
Yeah.
And it's posteriorly. It's posterior boundary is formed laterally by the petrous ridge and in the midline by the posterior clinoid processes and dorsum sulli. It contains temporal lobe of the brain, pituitary, and most of the foramina of the skull base. The posterior cranial fossa, which is the largest and the deepest fossa, anteriorly limited by the dorsum sulli and the petrous ridge, and it is demarcated posteriorly on the skull radiograph by the groove for transverse sinus, contains cerebellum posteriorly and anteriorly, pons and medulla lie on the clivus and are continuous with the through the foramen magnum with the spinal cord. This is the anterior, middle, and posterior. We said that the anterior cranial fossa limited by the anterior clinoid processes and sphenoid ridge, while the middle cranial fossa anteriorly the same, the anterior clinoid processes and the sphenoid ridge, while posteriorly it is limited by the petrous temporal bone and the ridge of it. And all have a content, the anterior cranial fossa with its limitation, it supports the frontal bones, while the middle contains the pituitary gland, and the posterior fossa contain posteriorly the cerebellum and anteriorly the magnum, which contain pons and medulla on it, and continue with the spinal cord. Through which the medulla and bones continue with the spinal canal.
The medulla continues with the spinal cord.
Okay.
Not medulla and bones. Bones does not continue through the foramen.
Okay. Midbrain, bones, and medulla.
Okay.
Medulla
does not go through the foramen magnum.
Yes.
Above the foramen magnum.
Medulla,
and
then
the bones go through the foramen magnum. The
patient.
Okay.
Okay.
And what's this image?
Three D reconstruction of the CT of the skull. لا أنا قريتوها لأنه يعني الدكتور اليوم أشكو. The foramina of the skull base. It is an important subject. We have many foramina of the skull base. We will talk that in which part it is present, this the foramina, and what type of nerve or artery or veins it transmits, and some comment on it. First, we will start with superior or with optic canal. We said that the optic canal on the lateral side of the optic chiasma on the sphenoid bone. On the middle cranial fossa, start and go to the orbital apex, transmitting the optic. It transmits optic nerves and ophthalmic arteries.
Which cranial nerve is optic nerve?
Second. Olfactory first. While superior orbital fissure on also in the sphenoid bone, it transmits first, which is called ophthalmic or orbital division of the trigeminal nerve, and the fourth and sixth cranial nerves fourth mean trochlear, sixth abducens, cranial nerve, and superior orbital vein, and the branch of the middle meningeal artery. This is the superior orbital fissure in the sphenoid bone, while inferior orbital fissure between maxilla and the sphenoid bone, not only in the sphenoid bone. The inferior orbital fissure has something interesting, that it is posterior part, it form opening between the orbit and pterygopalatine fossa, and more anteriorly between the orbit and infratemporal fossa, and transmit infraorbital nerve and infraorbital artery and inferior ophthalmic veins. This is the inferior orbital fissure between maxilla and sphenoid bone. You must remember what it transmits. While foramen rotundum, also in the sphenoid bone.
Rotundum means rounded, so the rounded foramen, foramen ovary, the oval.
Yes. Yes. Foramen rotundum, we said that the superior orbital fissure transmits the first division of the trigeminal. This foramen rotundum transmits second, which is maxillary division of the fifth cranial nerve, trigeminal. So by imagination, it go from the middle cranial fossa to pterygopalatine fossa. Here, it is not seen because it is submental vertical view, which is not seen. Submental vertical view not show us the foramen rotundum and jugular foramen. Foramen ovale, also in the sphenoid bone, it transmit the third, which is the mandibular division of the trigeminal nerve, and accessory meningeal artery from middle cranial fossa to infratemporal fossa. This is foramen ovale. If we go to another pictures, it is lateral to the foramen rotundum. Foramen rotundum near more median.
Where is it here? Okay, it's not shown, but where should it be? Anterior medial to number 7. Anterior. Medial.
Okay,
somewhere here.
Okay. Could be seen by occipital frontum. Foramen spinosum, I also in the sphenoid bone, it transmit middle meningeal artery from the infratemporal to middle cranial fossa. It is opposite of the foramen ovale. Lateral to and inferior to foramen ovale. This is from spinosum in the middle cranial fossa to the infratemporal fossa. Foramen lacerum, it's the apex, at the apex of the temporal bone. The carotid artery passes through its posterior surface. This foramen lacerum is the most medial one from the rotundum, ovale, and spinosum. This foramen lacerum. Internal auditory meatus, it is in the petrostemporal bone. It transmits facial nerve and vestibulocochlear nerve and the internal auditory artery from posterior cranial fossa to inner ear. Jugular foramen, we said that in the submento vertical, it is not seen. Junction of the occipit and petrostemporal bone, this is the jugular foramen. Not visible on submental vertical view. It transmits a lot of content, like internal jugular vein and the petrosal sinus, which drain into the internal jugular vein, the 9, 10, and 11 cranial nerves, and the branches of the external carotid arteries, which are the ascending occipital and pharyngeal arterial branches. 9 accessory.
Yes. You always say cranial accessory because there is another accessory. There's the spinal accessory.
Yes.
So cranial accessory and
Vegas the 10th and Glostof 11 Glostof pharyngeal nerve. Glostof pharyngeal nerve. Okay. The hypoglossal canal, which is in the occipital bone also. Yes. Vagus will accessory. Okay. Yes. Okay. Hypoglossal canal and the occipital bone. It transmit 12, that is the hypoglossal cranial nerve. Foramen magnum in the occipital bone, medulla oblongata to the spinal cord, also vertebral and spinal arteries and veins, and spinal part of the 11th cranial nerve. From the posterior cranial fossa to the spinal canal. Now we talk about the radiological feature of the skull base and the vault. We start with the plain film. There are several projections are required for a full assessment of the skull vault. But the standard projections are lateral, occipitofrontal view with 20 caudal angulation and town. Town projection means fronto-occipital projection with 45 caudal angulation. The submento-vertical view is used to assess the skull base and demonstrate most of the foramina, which talked about previously. View for facial bones and sinuses also include occipitomental and occipitomental with 30 cranial and 30 degree cranial angulation. The important is the pituitary. The pituitary fossa is visible on occipitofrontal 20 degree caudal angulation. With submento vertical view, but lateral view said that the most frequently used for its assessment. On this view, its dimension are 11 to 16 millimeter in length and 8 to 12 millimeter in depth. The dorsum cell should have well defined margins anteriorly and posteriorly. This is the lateral view of the skull X-ray. This is the pituitary fossa. We said that the dorsum cell should be well defined, and it has a dimensions of 11 to 16 in length and in width 8 to 12. This is the cell.
Where is the cell torsica?
This.
Okay. Wait. Where is the length and width?
This is the cella torsica, this. I know, this is the cella torsica. This length, this is the width. No, no, this is the mastoid, sphenoid.
Sphenoid, you're out
there. Sphenoid, air, sinuses.
الله يذكره بالخير دكتور عزمي الحديدي كل ما تفحص جفصة يقول صحيت الإكزامنا.
أوكي.
لما كان نايم أنت صح. لا تصحي الإكزامنا.
لا دكتور بالعكس ما يخالف نتفحص نتعلم. يعني نحن جنيد النام. Pneumatization of the sphenosinus may be rudimentary precellar cellar. Which is extending under the entire cella or extensive when it involves the dorsum. The third type, which is cella, is the most usual. There is an omega, G-shaped omega or hourglass cella, J-shaped omega or hourglass cella, which is prominent sulcus chiasmaticus. It is a variable, normal variant in 5% of the children. But I don't know if it is in adult, is it something?
Yeah. It's a normal variant.
The diplopic markings are large, irregular, less well-defined venous channels run in the diplopic space. For the diplopic veins, they are very variable in appearance, but a stellate confluence is often seen on the parietal bone on lateral skull radiograph. This stellate confluence for the diplopic marking on the parietal bone on lateral skull X-ray. The dural sinuses are wide channels that groove the inner table and internal. This is
to drain into the internal trigger. Okay.
Yes. Print error.
Okay. Let's stop here now, and we'll continue next week, maybe.
The topic is very long. Yes.
We'll continue. No problem. Next week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks.
Yani, it is not fair. Not fair, yani.
Thank you very much.